Hi, everyone. Welcome to Office Hours. If you are on YouTube and watching, you can look down below. There's probably a little link that you can use to join us in the future in Zoom, where the real conversation is actually happening. If you're here in Zoom and this is the first time you've come here and you're wondering, why are there attendees and panelists and how do you become a panelist and how does this all well, the panelists show up early. So we open at 6 o'clock in the morning, bright and early. And I can't promise anything between 6 and 6:30. It can go all over the place, which it did today. So anyway, so it can just wander around and sometimes it's technical and sometimes it's not, but usually there's some either technical or other fireworks going on. So it's fun time in the morning. Between 6:30 and 6:40, we'll distribute the Discord link. The Discord link is where over 700 of us keep talking about this stuff because 3 hours isn't enough. And then at 6:40, we start doing mic checks. Once we start doing mic checks, we're closing the panel. So if you want to be on the panel, if you're watching this and thinking that you know better than us, you might. So what we want you to do is actually come on and give us your 2 cents. And we, this constantly is changing. This panel is constantly changing and we keep on getting more smart people joining it and being part of it. And we want you to try that as well. So, so definitely jump on by 6:40 and do the mic check. While we're doing the mic check is a good time for the attendees. If you're not going to jump on, which is totally understandable, ask questions, vote on questions. Right now there's 178 people in Zoom and there's not 178 questions or votes. So get to work. Your job is to actually run the show as an attendee. You're running the show. You're the producer of the show. You're telling us what you want to talk about next and how ask those questions and push those things forward. So really it's up to you to drive the talent. us along the path. So ask those questions and vote on those questions. There is, if you're in Zoom, there's a link to the Mukana links, which are a Q&A inside the old chat goes to the new chat. And there's a desktop version and a mobile version that you can jump onto. Anyway, we have the first hour is all general Q&A. Second hour is all a more vertical Q&A based on what we're, what something we're interested in. So 8 to 9 will be Brian Vander Ark. He is the lead singer for the Verve Pipe. And so he's going to be here talking about his journey, ups and downs and across, and he's threatening to play a couple songs. So we're expecting him at 8 o'clock. And then tomorrow and Saturday, we're talking about education. So 8 to 9 and then 9 to 11, a lot of educators are trying to figure out how to figure this out, whether it's e-learning and corporate to university to K-12 and everything in between, they're trying to figure out how to sort this out. So we're creating kind of some open forums to just keep discussing that and trying to work with them as best we can from the media perspective. We can't fix everything, but that's a place maybe we can contribute. So that's what we have going on. And if you watch this and you think it's cool and you want to share it, of course you can go ahead and share it. We'll get you the link there and post it in Mukana. And I didn't have the Mukana opened immediately here, so I'm just going to pop it open here so you can. Let me just get this going here. We had a little bit of a technical issue in the beginning and I'm behind all the way through trying to figure stuff out. Here we go. So I put the link in for Mukana. That's the one you want to use. Don't share your own link. Share that one. That's a good one to do. Anyway, Chris, while I was talking, do we have any questions?
A couple. Yep.
A couple.
Right. So Martin Reutemann wants to have a discussion about Zoom original audio. And I know that your stance on this has kind of changed.
Yeah.
Explain.
So my stance on it is that you probably shouldn't turn it on most of the time. What we've noticed, and my stance at first was turn original audio on all the time. In fact, we instructed everybody to turn original audio on. But what we found was is that a lot of people's environments, their microphones, their pipelines are not really built for that. And so original audio is really important. If you've got a really high-end pipeline or you're a musician and want to play into Zoom, it becomes important. If you have an average pipeline or you have a noisy environment, it's probably better to leave it, let Zoom do some work on it because it will improve the quality of how it occurs for us. Otherwise, we just hear a lot more noise. We hear a lot more of other things there. And so it doesn't necessarily make a difference unless you're trying to get the absolute highest quality out of Zoom. And turn original audio on is 75% there as far as what Zoom can do. And the highest quality is to use something like Loopback and pass it into the into your screen share, advanced, share computer audio. That's the way to truly bypass most of Zoom's controls and get the highest quality audio in. So that's the so those are kind of two different levels of it. Even original sound is not original sound. Bill and then Tucker, let's keep it pretty quick.
Alex said generally, but I will say that it reminds me of the early days of audio recording when the three worst letters in the language were AGC, which stood for automatic gain control. And on small things with bad signal chains, if you turned AGC on, you get this horrible thing where every time it was quiet, the background noise would jump up. And as soon as somebody started talking, the background noise would dive down. Yep. And we're trying to avoid that kind of thing. AGC has, or in this case, original audio does a better job because this is 30 years after those horrible circuits.
But the reality is Zoom does a pretty darn good job of cleaning things up on its own. And so I think we only turn it off. I'm now recommending only to turn it off when I feel like someone's audio chain is capable of being good enough to turn it off. Go ahead, Tucker, and then Jesse.
Yeah, in presenter prep, we've been going through and treating it kind of like an eye check. I go through a kind of scripted piece, and a lot of it is going through disabling the automatic volume adjustment and going through turning original audio on. And we treat it like an eye check. It's let's listen to it. Let's talk for a second. Let's see what your environment sounds like. And we go for a least impact. So sometimes least impact is get the noise floor down using the Zoom processing. Sometimes it's leaving original audio engaged.
And it really just depends on the chain. Absolutely. Jesse?
I'd say the same. We just test it out. And then also one other feature for the listen on the listener end is in the account settings, if you allow the listener to enable stereo sound, if you have a musician or someone sort of doing that musical performance, then the attendees can enable stereo sound in their local settings.
Right. Hopefully everybody's set up for stereo sound on the send as well. Jeff?
I wouldn't use original sound unless they were listening on headphones or earbuds. So if they have open speakers, you're going to need to have that off so that Zoom can do the echo cancellation.
I think that Zoom does the echo cancellation no matter what. I'm not 100% certain, but I think
turning off the echo cancellation completely. It's high or low or auto or something.
Yeah, it's
even with original sound on.
As far as I know, yeah.
Pretty certain it will do it either way. But we can. I'm not 100% certain, but I'm 90% that it will do
it. Yeah, I was using it that way, and it does still work. Echo cancellation does still work.
Next question. Oh, go ahead, Tucker, and then we'll go to the next question.
So the echo cancellation does still work, but it recalculates it. So as soon as you turn original audio on, you'll hear yourself echo back for the first couple of seconds, and then it recalculates and reapplies.
Which is a lot like an iPhone. Anyway, not that I'm bitter. All right, next question.
And Doug Ferguson says, how does one deal with two different clients comparing prices and then one asking for a lower cost because they heard the price of the other?
Go ahead, Chris.
I would like to say, Doug, that what's important to remember, and this is just something I've always felt, what's important to remember is that your price should be something that is determined by what it takes to A, support your business, B, support your family. It shouldn't be some willy-nilly like, sometimes it's what the market will bear. But when somebody challenges you, let them go and just tell them, say, I don't deal on price. This is what I need to do this job for you.
Yep.
That's what I would say.
I'm always the highest bid. Like I'm always 100% of the time.
Me
In
too.
In fact, the last one that I got, I was twice the next bid. They did a triple bid and I was twice the number two and four times number three.
But you got the job.
Yeah. Yeah.
And why do you think you got the job?
Because
even though you were so
price.
High.
I don't compete on price. I compete on can we actually get the job done and will we do it well and will we be predictable and we'll be able to manage that whole process. And so now that you don't build that up by on the first time you meet a client, but you have to get that's where you want to be competing is on quality, on customer service, on process, on, a lot of clients, what you want to do is find the clients that want to pay for that and leave the clients that are asking you to cut your price to meet somebody else's price. You want to leave them in the dumpster, because what they're going to do is they're on a downward spiral to getting something cheap that doesn't really make any difference. A lot of people, you know, in corporate especially, want to check off that they had a live stream, you know, or had an event, you know, and if that's all they care about, then they should get people, you know, and the people who are bidding really low and the people who are looking for that, they deserve each other. And they, and you want them to all like be, you know, be in that little world together while you work for people who are paying you to do a great job, you know, over time. So, yeah, so anyway,
this actually happened yesterday, but right. The weird and sad thing was that they heard the wrong number. So mm-hmm. the number that they heard from, right. I don't even know who told them, was wrong. And so now they're pissed off that, you know, hey, you did the same event for this. Like, no, we really didn't. Like, the number right. wasn't right. But now I got to deal with it. And I don't want to deal with it.
So anyway, I don't negotiate very much. I try to make sure that the price, as Chris said, is fair. You know, like, this is what I think it's going to take me to do
it. You can justify it. Yeah.
I'm able to justify that number across things that are fair. And then that's the number, you know, and usually the reason I'm more expensive is because I bring more hardware. I bring more people. I bring more process than what someone else does. And that's going to make the event run better. An event, in the end, the most expensive part of live production is failure. You got it. Phil, Jason, Tucker.
Yeah, I think the other thing for those clients who are really trying to genuinely understand the difference between bids, if they have genuinely done a real bid process and they've gotten three numbers and you're the highest, which we are often, they're looking to find out who they trust the most. And it's really a matter of, can they look in your eye and have a level of confidence? It's not, sometimes it is price and you're just going to lose and let it go, right? But if there's an opportunity to sit down and talk to them and explain to them, you know, this idea of having confidence and buying expertise, then spend the time with them and they might appreciate that and then go for the higher number.
I mean, the other
trust. Yeah.
The other thing is you just have to remember when you're working with clients that every time you interact with them is sales, right? And every time you're right establishing what your price point is. So how you structure your emails, how you interact with them, what your stuff looks, what your decks look like when they get to them, what your quotes look like when they get to them. All of those things establish who you are and where you stand in the pecking order. That is something that's much bigger than the final number. Go ahead, Jason.
I frequently tell my clients and am comfortable saying, if the worst thing you can say about me is that I'm not the cheapest act in the book, I've done everything right.
Yeah.
Like, that's all there is to it.
Yeah. Yeah. Tucker?
I think all clients want to have at least a little bit of control over the final price. And I think they all want that. And if you only give them one price, then it's difficult for them to have any control over it. And they need to be able to go to their boss and say, I did this and it gave us this. And so being able to say, here's your price, here's two things that make your event better and cost more. Here's two things that make that you can potentially remove that don't take the legs out from under your event, that can, you know, make it less expensive if you need it.
And I definitely cut, I mean, someone will come in and say, well, that's higher than our budget. And then I'll reduce it, but I'm not reducing it like going, I'm going to give you the same thing for a lower price. It's like, here's what we can take out. And to Tucker's point, here's what we can take out without destroying the event. That, you know, it'll be a little rougher around the edges. And I make sure I state, these are the things we're taking out. This is the redundancy we're taking out. This is what might happen if we don't have that. If this is the reason we put those in was because of this X, Y, and Z, and we're taking some of those things out, and you might feel it, you know? And so you make sure that you identify what those things are and why they were there in the first place and why you're taking them out. Go ahead, Sky.
My favorite quote is, you wouldn't buy a Picasso by the inch.
Yeah, very good.
And my cameraman's quote is, I don't do video by the pound.
Right. And I think that the thing is that I want to work on jobs that where we're able to do it well, and I can hire, you know, I pay people more than average, you know, I tend to have a better crew. I tend to have better equipment. I tend to have a better approach to those things. And I'd rather work in that environment. If I'm not able to do that, if I'm constantly scraping down at the bottom, trying to go for price, I just move into some other business. Go ahead, Sky.
So the joke is on the wall of the garage, you know, time, quality, money, choose two. And I looked at that and I thought, no, those are the three qualifications of any process or system or service that we're selling. And the misconception that I'm trying to figure out how to have a conversation with the client is, at what level do you want any one of those three items? And so we flip the conversation to go, yes, we can do that for you, but it might be a different experience if we take this function, this process, this piece of equipment out. So let's have a conversation about time and what quality, because I've turned broadcast network commercials around for political systems in 8 hours, but because the system was in place and it wasn't cheap.
Daria, did you have something?
Yeah, I just wanted to say that this is a really lovely conversation to hear from the talent and creator side. And I really appreciate hearing your professional perspectives, because I know, just speaking for like younger creators and people on the talent side, sometimes we get a little squeamish about asking for what we're worth. And it's been an interesting time comparing prices for in-person physical events versus virtual events. And you know, for us, we basically do the exact same thing, whether we're on a stage or whether we're coming through a computer like this. And so it's just lovely to hear. And I just wanted to chime in as a reminder to people like me that it's good to hear you guys speak about this and think about knowing what you're worth and not being squeamish and scared about asking for what you know you're bringing to the table. It's a great thing to talk about, to like just normalize talking about money and not feel stressed about it all the time.
The value of your house is what somebody will pay you.
Well, and it is connected somewhat to the last person who bought the house or what you paid for it as well. The thing that I will say about it is that I start almost every industry that I get into doing it for free. because I don't have any proof that I know how to do that, you know, and so I find places to build up that proof, you know, whether it's for myself or whether it's for other people. But I find places to build that up, and then I start charging, and I don't usually change it for the clients that I'm that pay whatever they locked into at that moment when I was trying to figure it out is what they're paying for a while. Yeah. It's the new clients that I go, well, that was a mistake, so we need to have it. That doesn't account for all of those things. So the next client gets an adjustment as I figure out what it actually should be. But again, absolutely, not what market will bear, but what I can do it for, to get back to Chris, that we can actually have a company that works and people get fed and, you know, all that other stuff.
It's exactly the same as artists on our side. I mean, the guitars you see behind us are the friendship we've built with like our Taylor Guitars people and things like that. You know, it starts with relationship building and doing a lot of stuff for free. And then you get to discover that you're worth something. It's pretty cool.
We're going to stick with this just a little longer, then we'll move on quickly. Go ahead, Chris, and then Bill, and then Victor.
The last thing I was going to say is that the nice thing about getting the money thing out of the way and knowing that it's a good, healthy rate for what you need to do is once you get into the job, you don't have to worry about the money anymore. You can just concentrate on, let's get this thing done, because you have all the tools, you have all the resources, you have all the people. Now let's just perform.
Yeah, go ahead, Bill, and then Victor.
The two fundamental legs of pricing, I still think, are supply and demand. If you do your business so that you're on the supply side, so that you are one of 10 people who can do this event, you will never really accelerate your earning. You have to move to the demand side, where people are really saying, there's something about you that I want to work with, whether that's reputation or whatever. And it's exactly why you pay more for a Picasso than you do for something that I draw. The demand has gone way, way, way up because people recognize the quality difference.
Well, and again, it's one of the reasons that this forum exists, is to try to help all of us continue to improve our craft, you know, across, you know, whoever is willing to show up every morning to improve it, so that we can stand out from a quality perspective and not just be competing on price. Go ahead,
Victor. And then we'll set the market price on Discord. Oh, sorry, the mic.
So just to attach to what Daria is saying, from a performer perspective, you know, it's not going to make a difference to me if I'm performing for you live or virtually nowadays. You're not paying me for that performance, and it's going to be the same. You're paying me for all the hours of practicing, all the stuff that I have to do to prep. That's what you're paying for. The gig is free.
Yeah, go ahead. Right, exactly. Yes. Brian, totally. And then Brian, and then Jeff.
Oops. I wanted to echo again what Daria said. From my perspective, I do arranging. And as an arranger, you know, it's like, what does that cost? You know, it might have taken a few hours to do it. But like Victor said, it took years to gain the skill to be able to do that. And then from the perspective of my wife, who's a jewelry designer, she has stopped doing commissions because they become such a pain. People, oh, could you move this to the left and move this to the right and all that kind of stuff. And she's gotten to the point where she just goes, if you understand me and my way of working and that we can tell a story together through this thing, that's what matters to me. And so the price isn't so much the thing. And it's nice to be able to get to that point if you can, but that takes years.
And I also look at that for everyone I hire, you know, so when I hire people that I know how they work. I like how they work. And then I try to stay as much out of their way as possible. and get in there and help. Like I'm constantly asking, what do you need next? What is missing? What do we need to work on? But the folks that I generally have on full time, you know, I've worked with for years, and I know that they're just going to do the right thing, you know, and that's what I'm, you know, just expecting. Go ahead, Jeff.
Like Chris said, I'm having a set price that's your price. Then you get into the job and you feel good about it. So I have that price, and then the other price that I have is free when I want to volunteer my time and my services. And that's a great place to test out new things and to give back.
Yeah, absolutely. It really is a not discount, but free are the price that makes sense. Absolutely. I agree. Jeffrey.
Yeah. On the free end of what I do is I normally, I basically set two times that I'll give out free. So they have to be like, you know, like nonprofit organizations or anything like that, or something that I would really believe in, but I definitely put a limitation on how many free ones I give. And just going back to the original question, anybody that says, oh, I got this quote from this guy, it's like, well, you know, things are different, and you know, there are different situations here and there, and this is the quote I have. If you don't like it,
yeah. Well, that's usually someone forcing me to compare prices is usually for me a signal that I don't want that client. I mean, just so you know, like that's like that's where I may not get rid of them today, but we're on an end game. You know, like if I start having to compare with a bunch of other people and being constantly asked why I'm more expensive or whatever, we're in the end game. You know, of how that's going to turn out. Next question.
The projects that this whole thing came about is exactly what we're doing here. I mean, we had to pivot our production company to do virtual, and so I'm a soccer referee as well. Mm-hmm. And so I'm in the community, and I started doing Zoom meetings instruction for free for the local people. Mm-hmm. and then the national group heard about it, and then they're the ones that have the money and have a budget, and then a high school group in a whole other state, they came, and I went a little bit less because it's a high school group and I know the budget was less. And I mean, in the end, I still just want to help because it's a passion for me, and it's something that's, you know, to my heart. And so,
but this goes back to why sending discounted rates is hard. You know, it's like, it's, you know, it's sending discounted rates is Jeff talked about. That's what gets you in trouble is because they get passed around.
But I appreciate all your guys' input on this. And because I've learned so much out of this group in just doing these meetings. I mean, I have pivoted my company to do this. Awesome. So I appreciate it.
Thanks. I'm glad it's working. Tucker.
Yeah, I'm usually being super, super clear about if I am doing one thing for you and one thing only, the price is this. Mm-hmm. There's value in the relationship and in the long, long term. And so if you book seven things with me, yeah, we'll make something happen.
Efficiency is a scale. Next question.
Next question from Rizal. I'm going to turn my mic down a little bit because Mickey was not happy. For those of you who use AudioHijack and Loopback, do you always turn AudioHijack and Loopback on? I use them frequently. I'm wondering if I should just leave them on all the time.
I have problems. I mean, obviously, I get conflicts when I'm using them in other things. So it depends on how precise you build that. I don't leave them on and off. I turn them on when I eat them. Go ahead, Victor.
AudioHijack is not, it's pretty hungry for memory. So like right now it's taking 79% of my CPU. So I would not suggest leaving it on all the time.
Tucker and then Mickey.
That's interesting about the memory usage and CPU usage. I would say if you can live on it, because if it's a tool that you only take out when it's really, really important, you're not super used to using it, and using it whenever it's low pressure, is there's value in that. So I would probably try and just live on it.
Mickey and then Jason.
Interesting. Yeah, I'm the opposite. Like, as soon as I'm done using it, I close it, but that's just my habit, I guess.
Yeah, I did the same thing. Go ahead, Jason.
I'm with Mickey on this one. In general, it's not a great idea to just leave stuff on in the background. In my experience, though, there are two parts here. One, you have to keep it up to date. And I guess maybe as a side part to one, it's really, really important that you understand, you know, what's been patched and if it's been patched. So don't just, you know, jump in and use it. And then the second part is I find it to be very stable. That said, if it's not running, or if you're not using it, you shouldn't just keep it on, I don't think.
Go ahead, Roscoe.
Yeah, I actually have different accounts. So I have an account that just does all my ATEM work, does all my Zoom work, all of my office hours works. And then I totally log out, and that takes out audio hijack and loop back with it.
Okay, next question.
From Michael Watkins, looking for a wireless solution with a range greater than Bluetooth, more like 100 to 150 feet. I need the freedom of more distance from the computer during webcasts. Preference would be something allowing use of an existing mic or headset.
Go ahead, Paul, and then Tucker.
Yeah, I've unmuted so fast. Hey,
not fast enough, though. I don't know if you're the fastest, maybe the fastest in Austin, but I think you still need some work for fastest in the world. I think that
this is the Plantronics wireless. It's got about a 300 foot range. Mine has a 40 mile range because I've got it hooked up to an amplifier and a radio.
Why do you have four of them on your desk?
One, this two, is perfect, three, four, perfect five, question. Six, actually. Because I pulled them out of a box. I wanted to untangle all the cords. But I'll hook what one up in the
I
next
don't
time.
I don't think that's the core of the question.
Anyway,
these are incredibly powerful.
There you go. So Plantronics is a possibility. Go ahead, Tucker.
Yeah, one thing about the Plantronics and things like that is they're typically using the DECT protocol, which is very much for voice communications, not voice performance. So they're super limited bandwidth. They do have crazy, crazy range. So they're really great on range. If I was looking for something that I needed, that I wanted the quality of audio I have now, if it was just one person and budget was a concern, I would probably go with like a Shure QLXD. I don't much like them in any kind of difficult RF environment, but they can work pretty well. Then ULXD would be, you know, I've got a little budget and I want it to be really good. And then you get on up to the Axion stuff.
Yeah. Tucker, and how Plantronics could you be, has a Tucker, wide how, band how, option, by the way. It has a wide band
hands,
option.
Hands,
it
hands.
Does.
The other thing, the DECT is also used in FreeSpeak and in the Shure, they're kind of office mics. If you start getting excited about that platform, just be clear of, you know, where they're being used, because you can end up, especially in an event, you can end up with a whole bunch of things sitting on the DECT platform. And the one place, by the way, that FreeSpeak does not work, and also the micro, I can't think of it right now for some reason, the Shure platform is in Plantronics because they're all sitting on the same platform. Bill and then Jeffrey, keep it quick. We're running out of time.
I don't see anything in the question, though, that specifies voice. For voice, I agree with all of this, but if you're trying to do a signal that has bigger bandwidth, music or something like that, you really need to move an RF. And
yeah, you're going to now go to exactly what Tucker was talking about. Go ahead, Jeffrey.
Flight defending for actually Bluetooth 5. I have a Bluetooth 5 system in here, and I'm going pretty close to 100 feet. The other factor is if you are moving from room to room or if you're moving in an open space, that makes a big difference.
Yeah, go ahead, Guy.
Yeah, I'd say also running a wire with the receiver closer to the talent, so that way you can shorten that actual wireless hop. So the talent, if you can get the receiver, you know, at the back of the house, but you run a cable to the stage with some kind of way to pick it up.
Yeah, definitely. So there's a short hop. There's oftentimes a temptation to do something that is easy, like wireless is, you know, for to make it easier to just roll things out. You don't have to run so many cables. You want to just use wireless for exactly what it's needed for and only as far as it's needed, because it's just, there are the many things that can go wrong in a live event. Wireless is really high up there, you know, in where things can go bad, whether it's video wireless or audio wireless. It's probably one of the number one things that can go wrong in your event that people are going to notice. Go ahead, Tucker.
Yeah, at that point, just tagging on to what you just said, you've added another discipline. And when you've added another discipline, there's a whole level of professionalism and things you need to know to be able to deal with it when it has a problem. Because if you do hear a shup, shup, how do you deal with it?
Yep, absolutely. All right, next question.
Okay, our own Sky says, I have the ATEM Mini Pro, Blackmagic Pocket Cinema 4K. Yesterday on a live shoot, ATEM took over all color and the file type of the Blackmagic camera. Is there a way of overriding the ATEM, or do I only have ATEM Mini Pro to control camera once it's plugged in?
I'm just used to managing the Blackmagic and finally getting my color to look right. And then all of a sudden I plug in into the Blackmagic, into the Pro switcher, and it takes over the file type. It took over, and there's Victor. Victor has
Bill and Victor,
please. Yeah,
I'm experiencing the same thing. If I don't launch my Mini before I launch my Blackmagic Pocket Cinema Camera 6K and make sure that connection is stable before I do any color correction, if I add it into the chain, I will sometimes get odd color effects until I go back and retune.
Yeah, go ahead, Victor.
Okay, I'm not 100% certain, but I'm pretty certain that if you go to preferences on the ATEM and then go to mapping, you have your Cinema 4K plugged in, if you change camera from Blackmagic to none, I believe that will disable your ability to shade and therefore may resolve your problem.
Okay, and then
you can also give your camera a different mapping, yeah, so it doesn't, it doesn't have to be. Yeah. If you don't want to have any control, you can map it to a different, and it won't pick up the information.
I would like to have control. I just need to learn it, but
it's all or nothing. I mean, you can't have partially control. You have to decide the camera's going to have control or the switcher's going to have control. And generally, what I would recommend is getting your LUT really close to what you're happy with, and that and by capture it, take it into resolve, play with it. Put a LUT back in, get it in the ballpark, and then assume that you're going to finish it in the switcher, and then I think that you're going to be in a better, I think that's going to get you to a much better space and quickly. But I would never want to shade my camera in the camera if I didn't have to. Victor?
Also, just don't forget to also save your startup state.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah.
Yes.
There's
and,
that.
Oh, that. And then Guy, yesterday you were zooming in with the ATEM, and I've got the Sigma lens again that I think you've got as well.
Yeah, it's just a digital zoom. I'm not actually zooming physically. It's just that DVE. So when I click
in ATEM software.
Yeah, I've set up a macro to run to A and run to B that just pushes in 3x. So you can go, it's under the chroma tab under upstream key, and then scroll down about halfway. It's called flying key, and then change the size to whatever you want, and then set the keyframes A and B, and then
it's
you can do
so
that.
Deep. And the only question yep. I have,
I'll make
is,
a tutorial. Actually, yeah. I have one up already. I'll put it in the chat.
How does Tucker perfect. Know so much and be so young? That's my only last question.
All right, next question.
Tanya says, good platform for concurrent interactive activities, like a holiday party where one room has trivia, one room has a drink demo, and guests can go from room to room to have fun. I don't see the question.
Oh, I know. I see. That's because you're just thinking about the drinks. So,
no the drink.
I think that. I don't know how to easily do this. I mean, you could use meetings, of course, and break it into rooms, but, and there are some apps that let you bounce kind of back and forth. Go ahead, Jesse, and then Chris.
MIT has something called Unhangout, where you can create your own breakout rooms. So that might be something to check out.
Yep. And then Chris.
Well, what I was going to say is at the post-production world last month or 2 months ago, they just had a website where they posted where all of the different rooms were.
And it was just a link. And it was like, here's a link to go into that room. And then you could leave that room. And they were going to just to separate meetings.
Right.
So you could leave that. So that's
a very easy way. And there's a bunch of event, you know, whether it's Hopin or Shindig or, you know, there's other ones that are building events that are designed around letting people bounce around. I think that the thing we always want to be careful of is thinking through what makes sense online versus in person. I think a lot of times we're still stuck in this, like, how do we reproduce what we knew in the real world and in the virtual world? And some of those things make sense and some of them make less sense. And so I think that we want to always be careful of trying to reproduce the real world and in the virtual world, because you're putting the virtual world at a disadvantage. There's a lot of things the virtual world does better than the real world. So we're all together every morning. There's people all over the world. And so figuring out the best way to take advantage of the current technologies is the thing that I would kind of point towards. But there are things that are reproducing things from the real world into virtual. Just, I haven't seen any of them do it very well. Go ahead, Chris, and then Mickey.
Is there a way, I have an idea here. I'm going to, I'll save the time. I yield my time to make a better show.
Okay, Mickey. Thank you, Chris.
A question for Chris, like for that, though, that thing you had in, what is that, editor's world or whatever it was?
Post-production
world. How did they secure the rooms? Like, did they enable a waiting room or?
I think you had to be registered for you to actually get into it. It
couldn't be. And the moderators would manually approve.
I don't remember.
No, I don't think so. I think that basically it was register password protected to get into the website that let you choose the rooms. And I think that was probably, you know, so there's some control there of who can see the links, the doors to the room, but I don't think.
But when someone has the links, it's free for all, I assume.
In that case, I believe so. Yeah.
Oh, that's a little scary.
Well, it yeah. I mean, it's just a matter. I mean, it didn't, again, depends on how big you get and whether you become a target or not. Once it starts, you start hiding things behind that. And if it's passing that password from the link, I know that Grant does, I think, more complex things with APIs that tighten that connection between the website and the meeting. So
yeah, you could have a cookie or something hidden.
Yep. Next question.
Matt says, we did a live remote in an aircraft hangar this week. Wow. And we had an intermittent wired internet connection from the venue. I'm now looking for something that would automatically switch to bonded cellular when the wired connection drops.
The most popular device that does this is called a Live View. So that's the, there are other ones. There are TVU and there's other ones, but the best one, the one that is by far the most reliable and turnkey, is a Live View. What you can do is plug it into Ethernet. You can also have it look for the Wi-Fi. You can, you know, have it jump on the Wi-Fi, plug in the Ethernet, have it all at cell connections. It will prioritize, if you set it to, you have to do some, there's some switches to flip, but it will prioritize the Ethernet unless the Ethernet comes apart. But what it's really doing is bonding them all together. It's not just using Ethernet and then jumping over to bonded. It's using all of them, but prioritizing the Ethernet traffic. So the Live View is the most, and then we use, when we want to build something that's more bespoke, we use PEP waves, you know, for that type of thing where we, you know, but you have to have a head end somewhere that is connected to a real bandwidth. And then you're basically going through the cloud to get to that head end and then use that bandwidth there. It's basically a bonded BBN, essentially. Tucker and then Roscoe.
Yeah, plus one on the PEP wave. It's the HD series is the one that has the bond.
I think it's PEP link.
PEP wave. Yeah, PEP wave makes them. Yeah. PEP link. Yeah, they all, yeah, PEP something. Let me get back to the, lost the thought on that particular piece. But so that's one option. And the other is if you don't have something like that, stream over the multiple different connections and have an or downstream switch. So where you can choose which path you're coming from. So typically I've got two SRT and one RTMP feed, and I switch between those downstream.
And it, I just want to do correct us. It is PEP link, not PEP wave. I don't know why it's in my head as PEP wave, but it's
is one the company name.
The products are PEP wave. So PEP link makes them, but the products are PEP wave, Max BR1, Max BR2.
Yep. Go ahead, Roscoe. You're still silent. Nope. No audio. Okay. All right. Next question.
Jonas says the best way to sell host a pay-per-view concert, where should I add DRM, etc.? I just read it as it was written because I wasn't 100% sure.
Yeah, I mean, that's a...
The first question that I would ask is it VOD or is it live? And if it's VOD, I'm sorry, Alex, you had...
No, I don't have an answer.
Oh,
you know, we've been, the concerts we've done have been pretty wide open.
Yeah.
So
in order to secure VOD content, you can use URL signature mechanisms. The typical mechanism that one uses, that most outfits use now, are Amazon S3 URL signature definition version 4. It's well documented. It's used across most S3 emulation platforms. But the concept is you deliver a unique URL to each paid customer, and that URL times out, and it may or may not be specific to their IP address. And any other URL is delivers a 404.
And the turnkey solution right now for most of this kind of thing is Vimeo. I mean, they will do all of that stuff for you. If you are building it yourself, Colin has the perfect solution for that. And if you are looking for something that I just want to do it and build my own channel and have somebody else manage it, Vimeo does a pretty good job of that. I haven't seen anybody else that does it as easily and as well at the same time. Go ahead, Jason, and then Bill.
Oh, no, you got it. Pretty much plus one for Vimeo. The other way in the past that I've done it is streaming directly to RTMP and basically just setting a password behind a website and making the order number or the transaction number the password.
Go ahead, Bill, and then Jeff.
I was going to support also Vimeo or Vimeo Pro if you want a higher level account. The deal that caused me to hesitate about answering was the DRM thing. They have some protection and security built into that, but digital rights management is a kind of a complicated thing. And if you actually want to try to protect your content on those, you're going to have a difficult time, I think, with anything, because the crackers, that's the first thing they do is try to figure out how to crack through that stuff.
Yeah, it's worth pointing out that when one speaks of DRM, they're usually talking about file level security. And so preventing people from accessing content that they may or may not have downloaded without appropriate credentials. That's a different thing.
And it's always a weakest link issue. You just always have to remember that there's no real way to secure it. Like, for instance, all the DRM on an Apple TV, which is probably the most locked down platform, is based on supporting HTTP. And HTTP can be basically undone with a $40 box out of China.
So, allegedly.
So, you know, so if anyone wants it to, what?
Allegedly.
Allegedly. I, of course, would never do anything like that.
We've heard next rumors. Yeah. John Wells says, for one or two people talking and doing demos and keeping well socially distanced, is there a reasonably priced wireless lavalier microphone system, or is it better to run a 30-foot, 3.5-millimeter microphone cable for each person? Ooh, you're going to have fun with this one.
You should never run anything, any 8-inch jack or microphone.
First of all, I know you hate lavaliers. And second of all, 30-foot analog audio run.
Unbalanced.
Alex doesn't this.
Yeah. We would highly recommend. I mean, wired. Look, if they're not moving, wire them up. Like, don't deal with the wireless. I mean, if they're moving, if you need to use wireless, you need to use wireless. But don't just do it because of, you know, get the wires out there if you can. But balanced XLR is a good thing, and Dante if you can. You know, like just an Ethernet cable to a little box, or Ultranet if you're using some kind of XR18 or something like that. But do yourself a favor and don't do long runs in analog. Friends don't let friends go long in analog. Jason, and then Mickey, and then Jesse and Tucker. Real quick though, because we're running out of time.
We're gonna go to speed round. If you need to go wireless, please do not try to save money. You will pay for it so many times before you actually pay for it.
Yep. Mickey.
Yes, just doubling on that, like, minimum I would use for wireless would be like the G4 series or the Sony UWB-D series, which is around, I think, 600 US, somewhere there. Mm-hmm. And that's the minimum I would trust, especially if live. If you can go, as Alex mentioned, if you can go wired, go wired, but make sure you're running a balanced cable. Yep. For lavaliers, you can get little adapters that turn the lavalier into a balanced microphone signal. Yep. And yeah, you can really trust the wired connection. And you're mentioning socially distant. I don't know how distant you mean about that, but you might want to consider IFBs where the person could hear the other person if it's, you know, really far away.
Yep, absolutely. Tucker and then Jesse and then Jeffrey, but real quick, 10 seconds each.
Real quick. Mickey said it.
Okay, Jesse.
I'd say two shotgun mics in the time of COVID. You don't want to put lavs and packs on people if you don't have to.
It just depends on how roomy the room is, but yeah, possibly. Jeffrey.
Best way is to actually take the mixer and put it behind them. Then you can wire it up and then go wireless by yourself by using some sort of earphones. And then, of course, using an iPad or a computer to manage
it. Yeah, the least amount of wireless you can use in a production, the better. Next question.
Gabriel says, hi, all. Follow up from my question from yesterday. What's the best way to conform a 16:9 video from an ATEM to a 2:1 aspect ratio LED screen, software or hardware solutions with the lowest latency? Thank you. Are we getting into the speed round here?
Yeah, Image Pro.
Do we dare go to the speed round?
Yeah, we're in the speed round, but that's good. I would say an Image Pro is the lowest latency way to do the conversion to that. I mean, it's a Fulsome Image Pro. Is, I don't know if it's Fulsome anymore. Is it Barco now?
Yeah, Barco Image Pro. That's exactly what I was going to say.
Yeah. All right. Next question.
All right. Gabriel also says, when would you use NDI instead of RTSP or vice versa?
Go ahead, Colin.
When you want low latency and you're operating on a LAN. RTSP, I don't know what the latency is on RTSP. Does anyone have a number, general number
higher
for that? It's higher, yes. NDI. But I mean, NDI is anything you want to run internally to your studio or internally to your network, run it over NDI if you have to do any network activity.
Yep. Tucker?
Yeah, NDI, if you have the same layer 2 and no bandwidth limitations or, you know, reasonably low bandwidth limitations, RTSP, but not really that, probably SRT, if you're going beyond a single layer 2.
And all I'll say is that the only place I use NDI is inside of AWS between instances. All right, next question.
Damon says, looking for a piece of software that will log when and if an SDI signal drops as an alternative to a $15,000 scope. I was thinking of using an SDI to USB converter connected to a Mac. I have a couple of suspect audio embedders. Any recommendations would be appreciated.
Go ahead, Tucker.
If you have like an open gear frame, most of the open gear, which is like a Ross or a Black, there's a bunch of people that make open gear frames, but most of the cards that you can get in that, whether it's a DA, like an SDI DA or any kind of SDI processor, will do feedback on them. So you can get statistics out of them, but that's kind of an expensive way to achieve that goal.
If you think that it's happening, I mean, if it's suspect and better, it'll most likely show up. You don't have to do it for 24 hours. You do it for a couple hours. You're going to see that it's usually a packet loss, or it's very small pings of loss. I'm curious if you have an AJA embedder, because the AJA audio embedder and D embedders are noted for just running out of time. You know, like if they're in a high heat or high density area for a long enough time, they'll start to break down and start to add little clicks as they're losing samples in that embed and D embed process. And it's just something that we've known for a decade that AJA embedder and D embedders will slowly become not useful. If you call them, if they are that way and you are having that problem and you send it to them with or without warranty, they'll almost always replace them. All right, next question.
James Babbitt says, for better video in Zoom meetings, which lights would you start with that also are easy to set up and take down?
I think ring lights are the easiest one. I mean, we've gone to just doing 18-inch ring lights. Guy brings them in, makes. I don't know if he makes them. I can imagine Guy like hammering them together. But the Diva lights that the guy distributes are really good. But we use 18-inch. That's the easiest one for us to send out to folks. Bill and then Jason, real quick.
I'm going to support that same idea. Ring lights are great because they're soft, and but if you have to use one of the small lights, it's better to bounce it off. Like if you have a neutral color wall, and look for the CRI, the color rendering index of any light you buy. And if it's below about 90, watch out for it.
Yep. And keep really, really fast answers because we're running out of time. And Brian's here. So we want to make sure we get there on time. All right. Next question.
Stuart says, given how much better, yep, flattery will get you everywhere, Mukana is for Q&A in live events like office hours. Will there be a version of Mukana available for use for other events such as those run by panelists and attendees?
Eventually. They're just a bunch of pieces that we're still putting together. But yeah, I mean, that's definitely the plan. Next question.
Bill McIntosh says, when using Zoom with language interpretation feature enabled, participants can choose other languages to hear. Is there any way to choose a translated video? For example, if the host is presenting English slides but has translated slides, would participants be able to choose the translated version?
You'd have to put that into two different windows. So you'd have two different computers or three different computers that all have their own little windows, and then they could absolutely do that. Not on webinar, but in meetings, you could have people selecting the one that they wanted to look at. That would probably be the easiest way to do that, to give them versions. You could probably build something with Companion that let you go forward on each slide across the board effectively. So anyway, that'd be my guess. Next question.
Gabriel says, while using software switchers like Mimo Live and OBS, I noticed the program video starts to increase in delay, sometimes up to 5 seconds, and then syncs back up again with the live action. What are possible reasons for this, and how do you avoid this?
Your computer doesn't have enough CPU power or GPU power or both to keep up. So it'll keep the audio will never change in almost all of the devices because you'll notice it. If audio gets, audio is the most important part of your path, and all developers know, don't have the audio go one way or the other. So audio remains constant, but they throw away video all the time to keep up with CPU, and it's a lot more CPU intensive. So you'll get all kinds of lag, but that is why I use hardware. you can use software. Software is totally a valid way to do it, but you have to invest enough in the CPU and the GPU to make sure that it can actually handle it. So if you're seeing that kind of lag, you can probably look at your CPU power, and you're going to find that you're over 60%. And generally, if you're over 60%, you're going to start seeing anomalies start to crop up. And the closer you get to 100%, the more anomalies you'll see. Next question.
Alex, the Ubisoft project you did, could you dissect a specific component, maybe Masha's segment with a link there, and describe what prep went into it? Did she get points to cover ahead of time? Did you advise on staging? Did you live monitor and direct her? Who was shooting?
I don't know if I ever stated that I did anything for Ubisoft, and I definitely couldn't talk about it here. So anyway, next question.
That was a qualified no. Stuart again says, in my humble opinion, desktop Mukana is it's a bingo word. Yeah, I said it.
Yeah.
On monitors smaller than 28 inches or anything of a lower than 4K resolution, how open is the development team to submissions of other layouts, such as would be used on laptops or desktops in the 17 to 24 inch range?
Yeah, absolutely. In Discord, there's a Mukana section where that's why we put it up. It's only a couple days old. So the mobile version of Mukana was a dumpster fire before that. So it's we're figuring it out. Go ahead, Mickey, real quick.
Yeah, I just wanted to add that, on the desktop version, a bunch of the static elements there might be a bit oversized for a desktop screen.
Just post it in the Discord. That's why we're posting it here and trying to figure it out. So thank you for the input, and definitely put it in Discord. Next question.
Mike Andrews from Chicago says, I noticed that Mickey has a logbook on his nearby desk. I've always known that I need to write down the lesson after figuring out a problem, because months later, I'll know I ran into it, but have to figure it out again. Is logging a standard practice?
Go ahead, Mickey.
Yeah, well, this thing here is just my to-do list, because if I get the task or somebody asks me to do something, I'll forget it within 5 minutes. So I have to write it down. And that's just, yeah. But in terms of logging, like say, what do you call this, lessons? Well, for office hours, I keep a text document open on this, on my second screen here. And I just type down things I learned or links that I get. So I just keep text documents for that.
In most productions, we encourage our team to write stuff down in real time if it doesn't get in the way of their work. Don't try to think about solutions. Just write down what didn't work or what you don't understand. When I'm training people, I always tell them, here's a lesson. What you want to do is do the challenge and write down absolutely everything. If you're learning something, everything you didn't understand, you go up to something, even that's not connected to what you were trying to do, write down, oh, I don't understand what that does. Then decide, you know, I'm going to Google that. I'm going to figure it out, or bring it somewhere like here and bring up to the forum and we, you know, solve it. It's the fastest way to learn. Colin, Bill, Mickey, but 15 seconds each.
I like a tool called Asana for that. I use it for project management, but I also maintain a runbook for every project. That is, when I encounter a problem, this is the solution. These are the steps you take when you run into this issue, that sort of thing. Works great. Bill? But I only note, I don't like Alex, I only note things when I have solutions, which I can see the value of writing down problems only, but I think I would get really frustrated seeing
a live environment. Solutions. In a live environment, you don't want to think that much. You just want to write down what was missing and then later.
No, I see the value of it. I just think looking back at it, it would be really aggravating.
Yeah.
It's a giant list of problems with no solutions.
It's confronting, yet. But then you get a lot. Yeah. You just don't make the same mistake twice. Bill and then Mickey.
All computers have notepads. I use the Mac notepad constantly for this kind of thing. And I like switching from regular text where I just dump my thoughts to bullet lists or checklists that I can go through to do.
Mickey, real quick, last word, or then we'll go to Jeff.
I also have dozens of lists on an app called Clear. I don't know if you guys are familiar with it. And like, I don't know if you guys could see this, but I could just like drag down, type something in, then drag down again, add another entry in the list, drag down. And that's what I use like on a daily basis.
That's awesome. Jeff, last word.
David Allen's getting things done. It's a system.
Very good.
System for doing it. The tools don't matter. I love OmniFocus, but you can use paper, you can use digital tools, whatever you want.
Great. Perfect. And we went into the speed round and we did get to all the questions for the first hour. So our record is still pretty clean, and we are shifting gears. So I'm super excited to have Brian Vander Ark here. Brian is the lead singer for the Verve Pipe, and I have been listening to the Verve Pipe, for a long time. I think that if the first album was, I think if it came out, well, the first major release was a record, I would have worn it out. And I just listened to it over and over and over again. And so Brian tweeted something out and I just saw him. I was like, I wonder if I could get him to come and talk to us, you know, about the journey, about the process. And so I just sent out a random email, just like, I don't know if that's possible or not. And here he is hanging out with us. So I'm just super excited to have you. Thanks, Brian, so much for coming.
I appreciate you having me. Thank you. Thank you. How's my sound and everything? Am I all right?
Sound is good.
Okay, good. Just want to make sure. Let me get the reverb off there. Ridiculous.
That's great. And so if you have, so if you have questions for Brian, this is the time to ask them. So I'm going to start asking a couple questions, but and again for our panelists here, feel free to ask questions as you but if you're watching as an attendee, this is your moment and it's your job. It's your job to ask questions.
Not to interrupt, but Brian, maybe you should strum your guitar too. So we have both those. Levels. And then sing and strum at the same time.
Okay. I don't know if I can do that.
That's good. It's fine. We're good. Okay. So anyway, so tell us a little bit about how did you get into this? How did you start? When did you know you were going to be a musician?
Professionally, I started at 16 years old. I got a job at the Holiday Inn bars playing for the old drunks when I was still in high school. And people would say, play James Taylor, I'll give you $1. And I'd play James Taylor for $1, that kind of thing. I had a guy ask me once to play Cats in the Cradle, Cats in the Cradle, that classic Harry Chapin song. And this is a perfect story for this kind of experience for a kid. But he told me he gave me $5. I play Cats in the Cradle. I play Cats in the Cradle for him. He gave me $5. And he came up with his tears in his eyes. He said, "Brian, you got to play it again. I'll give you $5 more. And so I played it again. And then he came up again. Long story short, I played Cats in the Cradle for this guy 5 times in a row that night. And the only reason I didn't play it the 6th time is because the other guy in the bar paid me $20 to not play it again. This was kind of the routine. There's always like 3 or 4 people in the Holiday Inn bars every night during the week. But, you know, playing 5 sets a night, 5 hours a night when you're in high school, it was decent money. It was a little more than, you know, my friends who worked at McDonald's. So it was not too bad.
And doing something better. I mean,
yeah, I mean, yeah, of course.
More where you're going.
Of course. And, you know, building up my chops, you know, and I wanted to be a songwriter too. And, you know, and that was, I think that was the most important thing to me, was to have my own stories and songs like the Harry Chapins and the James Taylors of the world, you know.
Now, so. do you think it was important do you think you got something out of playing everybody else's music as far as thinking about song structure and process?
Yes, absolutely. Song structure. I was going to say the same thing when you started that question. Was song structure is what you learn. You learn that most songs have a structure to them. Most pop songs have a structure to them. And that's still true to this day, although you'd be hard pressed to find anybody writing a bridge anymore for some reason. Nobody has any time for a bridge anymore. Nobody, you know, the fear is that you're going to lose the listener by going to the middle 8, you know, which is the exact opposite of the way it used to be, you know. And I still write pre-choruses and bridges, you know, because I like to take the people on a musical journey of some sort instead of playing the same thing over and over and over, you know, within one song.
No, absolutely. And where do you think of, when we think of the listener, I mean, I think a lot of times we worry about losing the listener on radio, but do you think about radio as much today as we did before?
No, not at all. In fact, you know, there was a time when we were chasing radio, you know, what we got to work on a new hit. We need a new hit song. We need hooks. We need to, you know, get the latest, you know, record scratch in or whatever it was in the late 90s that was, you know, propelling these songs from these alternative bands to become hit songs. And everybody was chasing what the next trend was. And now the nice thing about it is that you never have to worry about that. We just don't worry about it. We can just write what we want to write, and we can have as many musical changes as we want, which I'll jump ahead. You know, the band made some kids records too. And those are the most freeing records to make, because you can put, if I were to put it, like, you know, the album Villains, you said, if I were to put an oboe on Villains, you'd roll your eyes and say how pretentious that was. Right. But if I put an oboe on a kid's record, right, a rock and roll kid's record, that poor kid who gets picked on, who plays the oboe, is going to go, "Oh my God, there's an oboe solo on this song."
And that's
so
great.
That's the nice thing. So that's where we are musically. We can do whatever we want to do. We have all these avenues to do that, you know.
And do you feel like you need to release albums now, or they're not albums anymore, but do you still try to release a collection, or do you feel like you can just release a small number or even singles?
Well, what we decided to do with the last album we did 3 years ago, and we're going to do it for this new album too, is we released a song a month. You do that for 12 months, and then you put the package together of those 12 songs and sell that merchandise. So, you know, make an LP or a CD. Although I'm not sure we're going to make CDs anymore.
Are you printing wax?
Printing wax.
Are you making records, actual records?
I want to say yes. We have our last two albums we're making records, and hopefully this one will too, but there's such a backlog and it takes so long to get them now that it's so frustrating. Eventually, you know, with a new album, it'll come out, but you know, 6 months, it's at least 6 months, 6 to months to a year to wait. The nice thing about it is that your profit margin is great. You know, you can make them and pay $5 and then you sell them for $25 or $30, and people who love vinyl buy them.
No. Right. No, absolutely. And what do you think is the, for you, when you look at these, all these digital distribution platforms, whether it's Apple Music or Spotify, which are the ones that you think are doing the best for the artists?
Oh, for the artists, I'm not sure that any of them are really doing great things. I mean, mm-hmm. You know, we had 4 million streams of The Freshman in 1 quarter, and we got a check for $200. I mean, that, you know, mm-hmm. you can't make a living now. I mean, music now for us, they're advertisements for your band. It's music is free, essentially free. And once something is free, you know, you can't you'll never be able to charge for it again. So you have to find other ways to market yourself. But, you know, I mean, I stream and, you know, my family streams. We don't like clutter of CDs and that kind of thing. So, you know, like the majority of people, we stream, you know. Mm. But Apple Music is what I mean, Apple Music's got access to everything I, you know, everything I ever listen to.
Right. That's the.
I'd be hard pressed to find something that in my collection that I can't find in Apple Music. So.
Somehow I'm able to find those, and I don't know why. It's a handful of, but they're I admit that they're obscure. But I'm just like, why isn't this here? So
I still lament the day that I threw away all my albums when CDs came out, and I know a lot of people feel that way too. It's like, well, I'll never need these again. CDs are forever. And I had this amazing collection. I was like, well, what do I do now?
No, absolutely. And then so you got your plan. How did you get to the Verve Pipe from Holiday Inn?
It was a very long stint in the Army right after the Holiday Inn bars. I was in the Army for 4 years and then I got out and went.
And what did you do in the Army?
I was in military intelligence. I was in ground surveillance radar. We worked on the border of Czechoslovakia and East Germany. And when I say the border, I don't mean like a border crossing. I mean, in the middle of a field, in the middle of the woods where there's just a, you know, border stone every 50 meters or so. That's what we did. We watched overnight with night vision goggles and we looked for any kind of activity on the other side. So if you saw any, you know, artillery buildup, that's something you would want to call in, you know, kind of thing, you know, but it was funny because I learned a lot of great things in the military. Not only because I had never been on an airplane before, I got all of these great experiences that, you know, worked well with my songwriting for sure. For instance, there was a border guy and a border patrolman on the Czechoslovakian side. And I kept seeing this kid look just like mirror image of myself, you know, young kid. And he had a weapon like I did, a uniform, and you weren't allowed to make any kind of contact or wave or anything because it might, you know, cause an international incident. And I remember wanting to make some sort of connection with this kid because I'd see him, you know, three or four times a month out there. And one night I took my cigarettes and I snuck up to the border stone. I put them on border stone. I went back to my Jeep, you know, 100 yards back or whatever, and waited. And then 2 hours later went out to see if he'd accepted my cigarettes, and he didn't. And I did this for a couple of months. And then one time I went out there and there I saw my cigarettes were still on the stone. I was bummed, but I picked them up and they were Czechoslovakian cigarettes. I was like, this is amazing. See, when you have that, make that kind of connection with somebody, especially during the Reagan years, you know, where all the Cold War stuff was going on and you heard all these horrible things about these people, you know, back before the wall came down, that was a really profound experience for me. And so it's experiences like that in the military that helped me out with the songwriting. So I wrote a bunch of songs and I went back to Michigan where I'm from. And then I formed a band to play those songs, but I did get a break from Willie Nelson. He came into town. A buddy of mine was a country DJ and asked me if I wanted to go meet Willie and get on his bus. And, he was going to do an interview with Willie and I did. I got to go on Willie's bus and meet Willie Nelson. And I gave him my demo tape and I left and he called me 3 days later and asked me if I wanted to play at Farm Aid 4 because he loved the song. It was written for the American farmer. So I got to rub elbows with Elton John was there that year in 1990, Lou Reed and Crosby, Stills, Nash. I mean, it was an amazing experience. So again, that's inspiration. So then I went back and said, I got to form a band and really take this seriously. And that's when I formed a band called Johnny with an Eye, and then there was another band called Water for the Pool, and Water for the Pool had all the great gigs on the weekends, and we had the 25-cent draft beer nights on Tuesday nights but everybody went out. So we built this following, and then I asked a couple guys from Water for the Pool, would you want to break up our bands and form a new group, combine our mailing lists, and record these songs of mine? And they did, and that's when we formed the Verve Pipe in 92. Yeah, and then we put out a couple independent records and sold about 40,000 of those, and that got the attention of RCA.
And so that was, and so you had a couple records on your own.
Yeah, we did. We did really well with those records. I mean, selling them out of our van, and we played everywhere. I mean, literally, we sold them out of the van.
Yeah, that's amazing. That's amazing. But that was when it. How did the interaction? How did RCA find you?
I suspect that, you know, RCA record labels at that time paid attention to who was buying from the record manufacturers. And I don't suspect this. I knew this. You know, they would look at these independent bands who were making all of a sudden, you know, the CD manufacturers, you know, manufacturing 10,000 CDs a month for this unknown band. And you go, oh, there's something going on there. So they'd send somebody out. So we had six or seven labels come out to check us out, including RCA, and they all passed. And then RCA came back to us again. And that's when that's when we had new demos, and they decided to give us a shot. So they signed us to a 4-album deal. Two of the albums were firm, which means they have to record them and release them. And the other two albums were just their option. They could, if the band wasn't going in the right direction, they just drop us, you know?
Right. So. And so the first album did pretty well.
Yeah. First album did really well. You know, it's funny. I wrote that album in a storage unit. I lived in a storage unit for a couple months, you know. Well, what bands would do in the 90s, which is a brilliant idea. I don't know if bands still do this, but they should. But you'd rent out a storage unit for 100 hours a month, and you'd store your gear there. But these storage units were powered, so we would not only store our gear there, we would rehearse in these storage units, and we would write and record demos and that kind of thing. And my girlfriend at the time, for what could have been a number of very good reasons, kicked me out of our apartment. And I was like, well, I'm going to go live in the storage unit because I got to write for this new RCA album. And so I went and I lived there, and it was disgusting, frankly. But but I mean, there's no bathroom, there's no kitchen or anything, you know. And every morning I would ride my 10-speed to the local speedway, and I'd buy the supplies for the day or whatever, and I'd use the bathroom and clean up and that kind of thing. But I would write, and I wrote these demos, and RCA. I sent the demos to RCA, and they flipped, and they sent them out to Jerry Harrison, who was Talking Heads and producer, right. And Jerry said, come out to San Francisco and record these out, these songs. You can live in this in houseboats in the San Francisco Bay. And, we're going to record where Fleetwood Mac recorded Rumors. And, when you hear these things, when you're a kid growing up in, Grand Rapids, Michigan, it's like your mind is just blown that you've made it. But it's only the beginning.
Right.
You have to get the priority. So fortunately, we got the priority with RCA because they only had us and they had ZZ Top. In fact, when we signed with them, other labels, I talked to Jason Flom of Lava. I don't remember Lava Records, but they signed Matchbox 20 and a bunch of other bands. But, we weren't going to get the priority there. RCA had ZZ Top, who was kind of on the way down, and they had somebody nobody had ever heard of called Dave Matthews. And we were like, this is going to be a piece of cake. We're going to get all of the priority. Well, it turns out Dave blew up right before we did. And then we got all the attention after that. And that would have really helped with our success for sure.
Yeah, because I think RCA had Live as well. I mean, it wasn't Live part of the RCA group, but they had peaked a little.
It wasn't Live. Jerry Harrison produced the Live records.
Yeah.
I'm not sure who Live was on.
I thought they were on RCA.
I feel like they were on Lava too, but I don't know. Maybe they weren't on RCA at the time. They might have been had distribution through BMG, but
yeah,
no, they weren't label mates of ours.
And how was it working with Jerry Harrison? How did he change your music or empower?
Well, the great thing about there are really good and bad things about Jerry, like there are about any producers. Sometimes you have musical producers. Sometimes producers will say, you need to change this chord to this chord and this kind of. That wasn't Jerry's strong point. Jerry was really good at arrangement ideas about adding an instrument. This instrument will go really well here, and this will go here. And he'd also be very good at saying, no, this doesn't work, and it's getting in the way of the lyric and all this kind of thing, so those were definitely his strong points. And it was really helpful to have an outside ear come in, because we had five songwriters in the band and five guys who butt heads all the time. It's nice to be able to have somebody be the director of the whole project.
Right.
And that was the first time that we had done that. And it worked out, terrifically. We've sold millions of those records. So,
right.
It's good.
And I imagine it was at times a pretty painful experience of having someone really, did he cut deep into what you were doing?
Oh yeah, sure. I mean, when you don't have songs that are chosen, or if somebody says your song is weak, this is a song that you've worked on for months. Right. I mean, they're all your babies, these
right.
things, you think every one of them's a hit song. And
right.
when somebody comes and says, that's not a hit, it's not even worthy on being on this record, that's a real slap in the face, but something that we needed. I mean, Villains really is start to finish ended up being a great album, and I was concerned about that. And, 95% of the albums that are released, or back then were released by by major labels were failures. I mean, they make all their money or made all their money on the 5% of successful records, and we had a successful record.
Yeah, and it, what I thought was interesting about Villains is that a lot of the hits came from the second side.
Yeah,
you know. So was there a plan for that?
No, we just always have this. We have this way of doing things ass backwards in this band. I mean, we knew the freshman was, you know, I had the very first independent record we did had the freshman on it, an acoustic version of the freshman. I'd just written the song, so we had it on there. The song was, you know, written in 1990. And then we knew with RCA they wanted us to re-record the song, and so we re-recorded it, and Jerry Harrison produced it, and it was not good. It was 6 minutes long. It sounded like a Chris Isaac track, you know, and it wasn't a good representation of modern rock and what it is today. So we had to go in and re-record it, even though we had already sold a couple hundred thousand records with that old Jerry Harrison version on it. So we went in and re-recorded it, but we ended up putting that on the second half of the record, which you don't do these days. You know, you would put your hit songs in the first three records because people don't have the patience to sit through 1, 2, 3, 4 different songs before they hear the song they want or they'll really like, or that is the hit song. But we did that, and the second half of the record did have the songs that ended up being the singles. I think, well, Cup of Tea and Villains were singles, but they didn't do nearly as well as Photograph and Freshman.
No, absolutely. And what's, so everyone wants to know what the story is behind Freshman.
It was a combination of made up short story I had, but you know, I had gone out with a girl for, you know, a couple of months, and then my buddy ended up going out with her, and I ended up going out with her again after they broke up and went back and forth, and she ended up getting pregnant by one of us and having an abortion. And that's where the truth ends. And then, you know, I take poetic license and liberties and make her commit suicide in the song. So there's some truth and some falsities in there, you know. But, you know, the nice thing about it was the lyrics. At that time, I was a pretty neophyte writer. So, you know, you go for the poetry. You know, everybody wants to be Jim Morrison at first. You know, everything's poetic and ambiguous. And the nice thing about that song is that there's enough ambiguity in it that everybody can take something from it. That's not something that I intended on doing. I think it was, on my part, it was just a poor way of telling the story. But things like "she was touching her face" were just random lines that were put in. But man, the first time I played that, I had somebody come up and say, "What was that song you played about the girl touching her face?" You know, and you go, "Wow, that's such a random line to pick out." And yet everybody remembers that line. I'll tell you, you want to know what that line was? I was sitting there, I had everything done in the Freshman, but I was missing two phrases. I was missing "We Were Merely Freshmen." I didn't even have the Freshman in it after working on the song for at least 6 months. And I didn't have that line, "She was touching her face." And the Freshman came about because I was noodling around with the guitar, trying to figure out, I had the melody, ba-da-da-da-da-dun. And I'm singing around, I'm all day long, I'm singing like, you know, "Gotta make some breakfast, you know, gotta quit my day job." You know what I mean? Trying to figure out what this is. And I'm sitting there, I used to work at a sporting goods store, and I'm going to be late for work, but I'm sitting there and the MTV is on in the corner and the sound is off and I'm noodling around. And I look down on the coffee table. I'm like, "What is this? You know, what could this possibly be? These two guys that did these things or whatever." And there on the coffee table is the VHS movie of the tape of the movie I had rented the night before, starring Matthew Broderick and Marlon Brando, called The Freshman. And I'm looking at this thing. I'm staring right through it. And then it hit me. I said, "They're freshmen. They're freshmen in college." You know, everybody can understand the things you did then don't matter now, and that kind of thing. And it was perfect. And that same morning, I look up on MTV and the Divinyls video is playing on MTV. I touch myself and she's doing this. And I was like, "What makes that sexy?" And I'm like, "Oh, I needed something that rhymed with whatever." At that point, I'm like, "Ah, just put she was touching her face." And then it ended up sticking. You know? Ridiculous. So one of the phrases ends up being the title of the song. The other phrase is such a throwaway thing, but it, for some reason, it still means so much to people now. Now, especially, I hear that all the time. "Please don't touch your face." You know.
Right. Yeah. Well, and it's really a fascinating like window into the creative process of a lot of things that sometimes randomly, you know, come in. I know for me that was definitely, you know, obviously thought of a relationship, not quite as serious as outcome as this one, but it was, you know, I think the nebulousness definitely had it be something that everyone could apply. Now,
yeah, that was the most important thing, I think, is that everyone, you had to make these characters sympathetic. They did these terrible things. Now, if this was a short story, it wouldn't, you know, it'd be a linear story and it'd be less, you know, ambiguous. But I had to make these characters sympathetic. And by chance, the universe, for some reason that morning, I had, and the night before, I had watched that movie. And that's how that's, I mean, every song you write, lyrics, they're puzzle pieces. And I'm working on 5-6 songs all the time. Like a little bit here, a little bit here, and say, oh, that phrase, I hear something somebody says, I say, that'll work in this song, or what if I made this work, or whatever. And just fit these little puzzle pieces in, and sometimes the puzzles, you know, ends up being a masterpiece of, you know, where it all comes together for some reason, and then other times it's just garbage, and you just go, oh, I gotta throw that away, this is no good, you know.
And do you find you take any old ones every once in a while and pull something out of one song and put all it into time. Another?
Yeah. My fans, the real fans, the guys that are there all the time, the guys that go to my Patreon page and want all the, you know, all the details about the lyrics and where they came from, will hear, they hear all the old demos, and they'll hear this line from this song that we released and this line that I never released, you know, back in, you know, 1985 that I used in a song from 2015. I mean, they hear all that stuff. So you can't put anything past them.
Before we get to a song, is Patreon been, and I'm just in full disclosure, we do some streams for Patreon, but has that been successful for you?
Huge. It's huge. It pays the mortgage. I mean, it's been,
wow.
I'm really attentive. I try to be really attentive to people. I answer all the questions when they comment. I comment on their stuff. I try to release as much stuff as possible. I'm doing a concert tomorrow night for them of the follow-up album, the Villains album. It's called the Frog album, and I'm doing that start to finish and taking questions, that kind of thing, you know. So I stay really involved in it, and you know, it's paying the mortgage, and it's just it's amazing to me. It's a great, great platform. Amazing.
It's great. Could we get you to play the Freshman for us?
Yep, of course. If I remember the words. When I was young, I knew everything. She a punk who rarely ever took advice. Now I'm guilt-stricken, sobbing with my head on the floor. Stop a baby's breath and a shoe full of rice, no. Can't be held responsible. She was touching her face. I won't be held responsible. She fell in love in the first place. For the life of me, I cannot remember what made us think that we were wise and we'd never compromise. For the life of me, I cannot believe we'd ever die for these sins. We were merely freshmen. Best friend took a week's vacation to forget her. This girl took a week's worth of Valium and slept, and now he's guilt-stricken, sobbing with his head on the floor. Thinks about her now, how he never really wept, he says. We can't be held responsible, 'cause she was touching her face. Won't be held responsible. She fell in love in the first place. For the life of me, I cannot remember what made us think that we were wise and we'd never compromise. For the life of me, I cannot believe we'd ever die for these sins. We were merely freshmen. Hey, yeah, 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 yeah. Hey, yeah. Hey, yeah, 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 yeah. We try to wash our hands of all of this. We never talk of our lack in relationships. How we're guilt-stricken, sob with our hands on the floor. We fell through the ice when we tried not to slip, we'd say
and be held responsible, 'cause she was touching her face. I won't be held responsible, no. She fell in love in the first place. For the life of me, I cannot remember what made us think that we were wise and we never compromised. For the life of me, I cannot believe we'd ever die for these sins. We were merely freshmen. For the life of me, I cannot remember what made us think that we were wise and we'd never compromise. For the life of me, I cannot believe we'd ever die for these sins. We were merely freshmen. We were merely freshmen. We were only freshmen.
Oh, thank you.
That was amazing. It doesn't sound very good in Zoom, so we've taken to the ASL version of it.
That is a great idea. Actually, yeah. I looked up and I was like, man, that feels better than that little clap you hear on Zoom. You know, it's like, that's nice to see. Thank you, guys. Hey, is the sound okay? I just want to make sure that the guitar
sound is amazing.
It's Mike Starr. Oh, good. I got a new system. I just want to make sure everything was
okay. So, Alex, can we talk a little bit about the how we're actually hearing him? Is he doing the little patch through trick that about? How are we hearing you, Brian?
I'm going to be in trouble now. I know this feeling. I'm going to be in trouble.
No.
Because I don't think this is well. I'm actually going through my Bose L1. It's called the Tone Match. And I just essentially go into that with my microphone, and I got a little compression on both, and then I go out the USB into my computer. It's pretty simple.
Yeah. So you have a separate patch for your guitar as well?
I do, yeah. So I've got two channels here. There's four channels. I use the two channels. So, and we worked it last night. I have to do another concert later tonight, and they worked with me last night. And I was like, oh, I could not get this thing to work. We finally got it to work. I was like, oh, great.
So, and that's new today. That's the new piece of
well I have been hardware. Using it, but I figured out how to do it now where it's in stereo and the whole thing, which is just I should know these things. But you know, when in COVID I've got no engineer help whatsoever from my normal people, you know what I mean? So this is a whole different thing, but I finally figured it out. If it sounds good, great.
We had this, we were just talking about earlier today that there's this complicated thing in Zoom where if you go into screen share and then you go into the advanced and then you go into audio only, it's the best audio you can get in Zoom.
I see.
But it's hidden. It's hidden back there. And then you have to use a... I think that they didn't expect anyone to really, you know, everything's been people talking to each other. They weren't thinking about musicians when they created the platform. And so it's hidden back there. And I think that was probably some engineer just left it open. Like, oh, we'll just make it high quality
what
there.
The heck?
Yeah. People might want to play music in there. And so, so we have to use Loopback, which is a whole nother little software to route it into the system software to get it all patched in. So,
crazy.
Anyway, but let me, we got a couple more, we got a lot of questions starting to line up. So we're going to go ahead and jump to the questions here. Phil Langer asks, who are the bands or what bands are on your recurring playlist? Like, what do you listen to?
Oh, yeah. Elvis Costello is a huge fan. I mean, usually I go for the lyric, you know, Elvis Costello and Andy Partridge of XTC. They're the guys that, you know, bully the English language so much and so much tongue in cheek and so many wonderful references. And those are the two guys that are on the constant playlist. Lately, it's been Elbow. I don't know if you know this band Elbow from England, but just phenomenal, phenomenal band. And they've been together for 20 some years, and I never go to concerts, and my wife and I go do destination concerts with them. That's how much we enjoy that band. So, but those three are on constant rotation here. My wife's a musician as well. Country singer used to be, she retired, but you know, so I hear Brandi Carlile a lot, and I hear Patti Griffin, that kind of thing as well. And these are the soundtracks in our house. Typically, and it's occasionally Imagine Dragons. My daughter loves them, and they're really great songwriters too. So, you know,
now I have to ask you now, since you had Andy Partridge, what's your favorite XTC album?
I've always loved Skylarking, but I hold a special place for Apple Venus because I was there. I actually wrote with Andy. I went to Swindon and got to sit right in his little musical shed, and we both sat on our amplifiers with a microphone between us, and we wrote. And then we went out to eat. We wrote a song called "Blow You Away" for the Avengers. Remember the old Avengers movie that came out? I think it was in theaters for like half a showing one afternoon, and then it was gone. But that night we went out, and then afterwards we had a couple beers at his local pub and some great Indian food. And then he sat me down afterwards at the computer, and he played me the demos for Apple Venus, and he handed me this giant black book, and it was his black book from the very beginning, where he's got artwork and lyric ideas and all this stuff. And it was just the most amazing experience to hear these songs. So I go back between Skylarking and that one, you know, yeah, although English Settlement's pretty great. What about you? Are you a big Andy Parker?
So fan? I am. I listened to XTC for a couple of years, probably almost exclusively. I think that, there is English Settlement, and then I felt like the other piece of that was Oranges and Lemons. So I felt like it's two different XTCs that I love both of them. And I like Skylarking too. I thought it was a little overproduced from my perspective, but beautiful. No, it was beautiful. Yeah. But I felt like Oranges and Lemons, there's so many songs, but that was like a fuller sound than what we saw, than the more basic sound in English Settlement.
Sure. I mean, I'm surprised you said that Skylarking was overproduced, because I always thought, I love Oranges and Lemons. The songs in there are amazing, but I always felt like that was a bit overproduced because of the size of it. It was so huge. There's so much going on in there. That's Paul Fox too. But I
think that was kind of Skylarking is on its way there, you know? And so it was like the bridge between the two different sounds that were there.
But the thing is, when you strip it all away, like there are radio, I have some bootlegs of Radio Stop Eyes that he did and the band did. You strip it all away, they're great songs.
Yeah.
It doesn't even matter what, you know, what production is. And he's so meticulous about production. And I had to tell him, Andy, it just doesn't matter. Your songs are amazing. Why are you worried about the sound of the kick drum? He'll spend 2 hours on a kick drum. And I'm like, why are you worried about this?
Yeah. Yeah.
Nobody cares but you.
I watched the documentary on XTC, and I had to listen to XTC for like 2 weeks. Like it was just, I realized I hadn't been listening to enough XTC, and I had to pull it. That's great.
That was a great documentary too.
Yeah, it's fantastic. Jeffrey, you have a question?
Brian, thanks for coming on. Really appreciate it. And being a drummer, I've been on that other end of the 2 hour bass drum sound check.
Sorry, I didn't mean to insult you.
Oh, no, that's quite all right. Going back really quick to your lyric writing part, I'm kind of curious, because I know my understanding is that production houses have a database of some sort to make sure that you're not tromping over copyrights or anything like that. How do you have a process yourself to make sure that when you write a lyric, that it's going to be a solid lyric from you, that you know where it came from and everything like that?
I don't think there's any such thing as a solid lyric anymore. I mean, there's a way to twist things. There's a way to, like I was saying earlier about them bullying the English language, you know, but I really haven't had to worry about that. I feel like, you know, every song has been written essentially, and the lyric is, you know, to write here. Here's the thing. The real challenge is to write the perfect love song. You know, it's really difficult to say I love you in a different way, because it's been said so many ways. You know, so that, I think that is the bar. That's the goal, not the bar. I mean, that's where you want to be, of course, as the bar then, but that's the goal. No, I'm never really worried about that. And I think the database you're talking about, I've never experienced that. I've never had an A&R man say, well, look, we got to put that through and make sure that all this is clean. There's so much music out there that, you know, for me to do that, I'd have to worry about that. I wouldn't get anything done. I'd be so worried about it. Well, this is too similar to the Peter Gabriel. I don't even worry about it. I figure if I do something too similar to Peter Gabriel and Peter Gabriel sues me, then I've made it. Can't get much better than that.
Yeah, exactly. That's great.
I feel like I literally stole from Paul Simon. I stole a call from Scarborough Fair that if I play the chord, you'd go Scarborough Fair, and I stole it from then. I thought the same thing. I thought, well, if Paul Simon ever sues me, then great.
Perfect. Well, the funny thing is that the other band that that is very close to your band's name had that problem, right? I mean, they...
Oh, yeah, the Verve. Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. We escaped that whole thing. First, they got sued by Verve Records, which was the jazz label.
Right.
And then they had to change it to The Verve. And then they, yeah, then they took the Rolling Stones bit, you know. So it's like, those guys. You know.
How ironic. Roscoe Jones asks, what does it mean to a musician to see their music on a movie soundtrack?
I mean, for me personally, I can only speak for me personally. I think it's amazing. I love the idea of a director taking what I've written and putting it in a movie and putting their interpretation of what the lyric might be up on the screen with actors. It's an amazing experience. Now, we had a song called Colorful in the movie Rockstar. And I read the script and then I specifically wrote that song for the movie. And Mark Wahlberg sings the song in the movie, the end of the movie. He sings it to Jennifer Aniston. He lip syncs to my voice, which is really weird. But the idea that you actually have something on there and you can see it happen is there's no greater thrill. And I've written a lot of songs for a lot of movies that a lot of people did not go see, frankly. but it's still that great feeling, even with the independent films, to hear, you know, your words come out of actors' mouths or to see a scene that you never would have thought would have fit. You know, I'll give you an example. TV is a little different. We had Never Let You Down was a song that did pretty well for us. Happy poppy song. And America's Funniest Home Videos used it. So that's a nice chunk of change there. But then they put an image of what you think is a nice, beautiful love song. And they put images of people getting hit in the crotch with things. And you go, this is not really what was intended.
You know, do you ever worry about that negative connotation of that one, someone using it? I mean, I think that you see that in TikTok, someone will take a song and do something completely unconnected to what that song means.
Sure.
And do you worry that someone will take your song and just no one will ever hear that song that way again? You know,
I'm happy that people use the song. You know, honestly, yeah. There, you know, back when The Freshman came out, there was a parody about the freshman 15 putting on the weight in college, you know, and mm-hmm. that kind of thing. It's a very funny video, and I'm flattered that people want to do that, you know. I understand what you mean, though. If you have a really serious song about a serious topic and somebody makes fun of it and that kind of thing. That never bothered me. It would never bother me.
That's great. Sky.
I had to step out. I apologize, but I got to experience your music in the car over nice. YouTube. And the Nissan Leaf has a great sound system, and the music was awesome. Thank you.
Oh, I appreciate it. Thank you. Thanks, Sky. For that.
Thanks. Jason asks, do you miss the format of the album, or does it push you to make each song standalone?
That's a great question. It's easy for me to answer. I love albums. I grew up on albums. We have albums now. You know, our kids listen to albums. It teaches kids, I think, especially that music should be an experience. You know, when I was a kid, you'd take the album and you had to do things. You know, you take it out, you clean it, you put it on, you go sit in your beanbag chair, put your headphones on. This is when I was a kid. My kids would do this.
Yeah.
But then in 30 minutes, you're committed to, or 20 minutes, you're committed to turning that album over. So typically you're sitting there. It's not just background music, you know, going on all the time, which right. I don't like nearly as much. So I love the concept of the album. What was the second part of the question? I'm sorry.
Do you feel like it? Go ahead, Jason.
Do the songs need to stand independently? Yeah. Otherwise. Yeah. I think any songwriter will tell you that every song has to stand that independently, has to stay by itself independently. However, and Alex, you know, you said you're an XTC fan, segues from one song into the other.
Oh, yeah.
We do that a lot too. And I love that. I love that one song goes into the next, because I really feel like that album should be a journey, and it's important to keep that journey. And what drives me crazy is I'll hear, you know, one of our songs on, you know, whatever I'm streaming or whatever, and I'll hear it. And then, you know, the end of it will be cut off because it goes into the next song or that. Or you hear the beginning of the next song because we decided to segue. Remember 8-tracks? And I don't know if you guys are old enough for 8-tracks, but 8-tracks, used to fade out in the middle of a song and then go and change to the next track and then fade out. It was the most, and we all accepted it. It was the most ridiculous thing. But it was like, it's an 8-track. I can play it in my car, you know.
I know even when I was making mixtapes as a kid, it was always like, what song goes to the next song is the next song, you know, and albums are very much that journey.
Love
and definitely XTC, older Genesis, all that stuff was all, you know, building an entire experience. Colin, you had a question?
Yeah, I was trying to figure out how to formulate this without making it about politics. But I mean, as an example, I'm trying to figure out how much control do you find you have as an artist with regard to the usage of your music. I know, I mean, recently we've had a bunch of musicians complain about their use of their songs in political campaigns that they may or may not agree with, or other events that where the operators are not particularly motivated to go get proper licensing. And how much control do you find that you have over that sort of thing?
I mean, you have as much control, I think, as you want, and as much as you'll litigate, you know.
So that it's driven just by litigation then. There's no,
I think so. I mean, I can tell you this. I mean, if I were to be completely honest, you know, I know Nickelback, you know, had you know, their sales went through the roof when the song Photograph, you know, that Trump had used for, you know, for one of his tweets, and then, you know, suddenly they've got, you know, 10 million streams on the song that hadn't been heard in so long. And I had to go, wow, would I shut that down? You know, do I feel that strongly about the song that I would say, no, it's got nothing to do with this or whatever? Or would I accept the fact that, you know, we just got a nice big boost in our career again? That's a tough call. I mean, if I were Nickelback, I might just kind of ignore the whole thing. Now, playing our song at a rally any political rally, I guess I'd be happy. I'm not particularly fond of the Trump rallies, but, for me, I don't think I would ever litigate. I think letting it happen, you know, however mm-hmm. you let it happen is fine. You know, we never get political at the shows, you know, because we've got people that are the left and right come to our shows, and they don't go to the shows to, you know, to want to hear or talk about politics. They go to the shows to escape all of it. At least I do. And so that's the way we look at it, you know.
No, I'm sorry. I was trying to formulate it in a way that was not about politics.
No. I get it, though. Yeah. I get it. But it's a great question. Yeah. It's something that I struggle with. I mean, that's mm-hmm. it's a great question, Colin, because I do struggle with that, you know.
Yeah. Mickey asks, for this stream, is your car, I think we talked about this a little bit, on DI or mic'd? And what's the choice? Is it usual for your setup in the studio?
I'm sorry. Can we repeat that
question? Is your guitar DI'd or is it mic'd?
Right now it's DI'd. Yeah, right now it's DI'd. I just wanted to be able to separate it as much as possible. And I'll DI it live too. Depends on the size of the place, of course, too. But mostly it's DI'd. Yeah.
Yep.
There's a specific sound that's, you know, I'm fortunate that this guitar and this pickup has been, you know, I've had this for so long. And every studio engineer, when we're in the studio, it's always mic'd. But live it's typically DI'd. It's just too hard to control it with a mic, right? Especially if you're moving around, you know, you can't move around and you're tethered to it, you know.
Right. Absolutely. Roscoe asks, what makes the spectacular show, a stage show, which the Verve Pipe is known for? Who decides on what goes into the show?
I typically decide what goes into the show. I'm an entertainer, and I think everybody in our band, we want to be entertainers. We want to go to a show and be entertained. I'm not a big fan of the shoegazer type bands, you know. I don't hate them, but I mean, I'd much rather be entertained and have things going on. And the band that we have together has so many, everybody's so talented individually by doing little things here and there, you know, they're all songwriters. So, you know, Channing will get up and have her moment in the show. And we make sure that moment's compelling, you know, it's gotta be a great song and a great moment for her, you know, 2 or 3 minutes of something else going up on stage, somebody else singing on stage for a minute, getting together and gathering around a microphone and singing 4-part harmonies together for one song a cappella. That wasn't a cappella on a record. These are interesting things that you can do to make it great. When bands just go out and plug in and play, sometimes it's great, I admit, but sometimes I'd like to see a little bit more and have them not rely just on the spectacle of the lights and the explosions mm-hmm. like Kiss. You know, we toured with Kiss for 30 dates, the worst gig of my life. It was an awful gig. No, listen, I'm a huge Kiss fan, but the Kiss fans do not want to see an opening band, believe me. That was a horrific, horrific experience. Well, imagine 20,000 people in any city, right? They this is 1996. Right. Kiss finally put the makeup back on. They got the original members back together. They're going to go out on the road. The 20,000 Kiss fans buy tickets, and 20,000 Kiss fans wait for 3 weeks or whatever to see the show.
And you're another hour between them and their...
It's ridiculous, the fact that they've been waiting so long, and lights go down, everybody roars in anticipation to seeing Kiss, and then the lights come back up and this stupid band you've never heard of is on stage. It was a miserable 30 minutes of booing and spitting and the whole thing. So, but they, you know, Kiss relies on, and Kiss doesn't have to, because there are some really good Kiss songs, but they rely, of course, on the spectacle, and that's what people expect out of them, you know. Right. But not us. I mean, I really want the spectacle to be, we can take that spectacle of having each member be multi-instrumentalist and go into a small club or do it on a big stage, and it's still the same show, you know.
Yeah. Chris?
I had a question. I live in Sacramento, and there's a really great live music scene here. There's so many great bands, and my wife used to be in a band, and we have some really dear friends that are super struggling now with all the venues being shut down. Yeah. That absolutely, and I've even tried to encourage some of them to like do something online, and they're so arm's length, like, nope, if there's no crowd, I can't play. And and yet I'm watching them really struggle, you know, losing tons of gig, you know. It's just like, what kind of advice do you give to somebody about trying to maintain a connection with your audience in a little box?
Yeah, it's a difficult thing, you know. I'll try to make this is a bit of a long story. I'll try to shorten it. But back when the Verve Pipe put out our album Underneath, which was the album that was going to be our comeback album, because we had blew it with the album before, which was the follow up to Villains. You know, we thought we were going to sell millions, and we sold, you know, 10,000 or something. And we had this hit song that was on the radio, number 20 with a bullet, and we had the song in Colorful, a song called Colorful and Rockstar, and so we were ready for superstardom again. And our album was released about a week after 9/11, so couldn't promote anything, nobody went and saw Rockstar in the theater, that kind of thing. We had to find ways to do it. I sold everything, I bought an RV, and I went and I traveled around, and then I started what I called the Lawn Chairs and Living Rooms tour, which I went out into people's homes. I just basically strangers' homes, my fans, and they'd book me, cut out the middleman, and I'd go in and I'd play in, you know, in their home. And that was a tremendous way to make a living when there was so hard to make a living, knocking on somebody's door and playing for 50 of their family and friends. And I would do two or three of these a day. I had the model down for 14 years that worked so well. And it was easily the six figure base income was just doing house concerts. Now that's all gone. And I have to figure out now how to perform. Well, the Patreon thing, if you want a real connection with fans or any other platform that will do that, be connected with your fans by that way. Do these specialty concerts and that kind of thing. I think the idea of figuring out how to make your Zoom concert more interesting, these are the challenges that we face. You have to love to perform. And if you're performing because you need the energy of the crowd and the applause, then I don't know what to tell you. This time, I would pick this time right now to be creative. Now's the time to create content, as much content as you probably can, because in any industry, content is king. And this is the time to create. Me, I'm able to create, and I don't mind that, you know, that I don't hear the applause. I hear constant applause in my head anyway, in my way.
I totally understand.
Everything's a show up here, so I'm probably the wrong guy to give advice. But
I walk in the room.
Yeah,
standing ovation.
Right. Yeah. Luckily, I have young kids that bring me right back down, for sure.
Jason, but you had a question.
I think you have to put yourself out there, and you have to think outside the box. I mean, it's like any industry. It's so hard to make a living in the music industry now. You've got everything going against you now, especially with the venues closing down. There aren't any outlets. You're not getting paid for streaming. Your songs are free, but your songs are also advertisements. They're 3-minute advertisements to what you can do as an artist, and get as many of those out there as you possibly can. And the people will come around. And when this whole thing is lifted, you're going to find yourself in a better place than before. It's just a tough time right now.
Yeah, absolutely. Jason?
Incidentally, I was a freshman in college when a plane flew into the World Trade Center, and it was awful. I too am a very big fan of the album, and I guess my question is, if albums were to make a comeback, how would artists facilitate that? What would they do differently to kind of recreate the art of the album?
Well, the albums have made a comeback. LPs have made a comeback. I'm not sure that people are embracing it the way it used to be. You know, when albums first started, it was still like, think about Beatles put out 4 records a year in the beginning and that kind of thing. And they were just a quick way to get the music to the people. But over the 60s, you know, you had, like we talked about, where things started to segue into another, and it was an experience of putting the album on. I haven't found that yet with bands today as much as back then, but I think it's going to end up going that way again. And I do think people are going to embrace it. What has to happen is there have to be more manufacturing houses. All of them closed down. There's only a few open, and it's really hard to get your albums made in a timely way. By the time your album's done, you're waiting 6 months to get your albums to be able to go out and sell them. That's the most difficult thing. But I do think it's going to make an even bigger comeback.
The one thing we skipped over in the process was, how did you come up with the name of the band? It's from Tom Weiland.
Oh, yeah. That was our guitarist. Our guitarist was in the band for 4 months, and he came up with this awful moniker. I mean, it did. It was 2 words that, you know, we were arguing over bands. I mean, I, you know, we were talking about the Big Whoop or the Big To Do or these other things, something with the word big in it, which was ridiculous. But he just said one night, he said, "We're going to call it the Verve Pipe, and screw all you if you don't like it." Which was very, very him, which is why he was only in the band for 4 months. And he left, and he came in the next day, and he said it again, but he said it with such reverence. He's like, right. He grabbed me and he said, "Brian, say it with me. The Verve Pipe." You know, here we are, 2 idiots in our long, you know, it's the middle of winter, and we've got shorts on and combat boots and long coats, you know, and he's saying this to me. And it sounded so good when he said it. He had such, you know, he had such passion for it that I said, "All right, we'll do it." And it wasn't but a month later that we saw, or 2 months later, that we saw that the Verve in England had a band, and that they were making an album. And we thought, well, what are the chances that, you know, they would make it and we would make it? And turns out that our singles were like within months of each other.
Yeah, exactly. It was a very confusing time for all of us. It was like the Verve or the Verve Pipe, or which one do you mean? And it was a...
Oh, Alex, people still request songs. I still see, the worst was, I saw this little 4-year-old girl at our show holding up a sign, a homemade sign. It's just holding up the whole show for Bittersweet Symphony. I'm like, oh, all I can do, darling, is just blame your parents. So sorry.
Now, TJ Asher asks, are music videos still relevant? Do you think they have any value now?
I think there's value in them if you look at them as short films. I don't think there's value in them as a platform to sell your music as much. I think there's value in, like we talked about earlier, the you know, the feeling of having my song put into a music video and somebody else's rendition of what the song might be, or their interpretation of what the song might be. I think there's value in that. I think other artists will appreciate that. You know, we worked with Lawrence Carroll, who did all the artwork, art direction for Smells Like Teen Spirit. And he directed our video for Photograph. Well, he's a Michigan guy too, a Northern Michigan guy. And then a few years ago with our album Overboard, I contacted him and said, "Would you ever consider doing this?" And he did it for free and made this beautiful video for this song Overboard that Jeff Daniels and I wrote. And it's gorgeous. And it's so worth it. Although, you know, we've only got, you know, 20,000 people have seen it. It's still worth it to put it out there, you know?
Yeah, so. Absolutely. Now, Philip Tesoro said, he says there's a, he feels like there's a very, very slight Irish lilt to your voice. And he said, was there an artist that you used to emulate when you were younger that might have affected that?
I don't know where that comes from. You know, can't even watch the old videos because it's such an, there's such an affected voice there. I don't know what that was. I think I was, I can't even say. It had to be the English, a cross between the English and Irish bands that I'd listen to, but I don't know. If I still have that, then that's not good. I don't know.
No, it might be
my microphone. You guys are tech guys. Is there some? Well, yeah, there's some switch on here that.
Yeah, exactly. Well, before we run out of time, can we get you to play another song?
Yeah, I heard you were a big fan of Penny.
I thought Penny is just such a. I just thought it was poetry. You know, just an amazing.
That's one of the few songs I've written about a girl actually called Penny who broke my heart. So, let's see. Blushing ain't clue for her falsities. Advantage is my only masterpiece. Penny is poison, but I don't mind. Penny is poison, but I don't mind. got any malice for murderers? Flushes to me are the weeds to her. Penny is poison, but I don't mind. Penny is poison, but I don't mind. We know who we are. We know who we are. We know who we are. Starving the love of the marvelous. Hours of penny to previous. Penny is poison, but I don't mind. Penny is poison, but I don't mind. We know who we are. We know who we are. We know who we are. Got any malice for murderers? Flushes to me all the weeds to her. Penny is poison, but I don't mind. 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 Ah, looking for the waves. Love it.
Amazing.
Look at me. I need the waves now. I'm going to need to get my fix.
So, Brian, thank you so much for your time.
Oh, what a pleasure. What a pleasure to be here and talk to you guys, for sure. Just
really an honor to have you here and hang out with us for an hour. We really, really appreciate it. When's your new album coming out?
Well, everything got pushed back a little bit, where we're still writing for it. So we've got about 7 songs now in the bag. I would say about 3 months from now, look for the new album, and then we'll follow it with the tour early next year for sure.
And is your Patreon under the Verve Pipe or under you?
It's under me, patreon.com/Brian Vander Ark. You can find me there. Yeah.
Oh, that's great. Chris, you had a last question there, Chris?
No. Good. I'm good.
He just did an extra wave for me. That's how much he appreciates.
Cats in the Cradle.
Well, I will say there's multiple people in the chat that are would love to help. And I, you sound great.
Thank you.
But you were saying, maybe I could get some help. There's plenty of people here that would love to help. Alex will help teach you how to do the cool patch through. I will volunteer Alex's time to help you do that.
Nice. I appreciate
Thank
that.
You. I will say about half of our group are audio engineers. For whatever reason, we've collected a lot.
That's why I was worried about playing this show. I knew that was going to be an issue.
but if you ever have any, this is always a place for you. If you ever have any questions, you can always come back up
and say, hey, I'm
working on this pipe. If you're working on something over there and you have a question, I guarantee when it comes to audio,
the answer is in this room.
Answer is always in this room, and we would love to have you come ask us. You know, if there's ever something you're trying to figure out, it would be our honor to have you come.
Any opportunity to go on to a show where I don't have to play and sing would be amazing. In the morning, at least.
Well, come in. We're here every morning at 7 a.m. So, or 10 a.m. or 10 a.m. or 7 a.m. Pacific.
Yeah.
So we would.
Yeah.
We would love to have you. So
Thanks,
on whenever you feel like it. Absolutely.
I appreciate that.
Thank you, Brian. I'm sure we'll see a bunch of us will see you on Patreon now. So
I love it.
I know. I'm going to jump on. So thank you. Thanks everybody. Again, this is a show that you guys run. we just kind of try to keep it going roughly in the same direction. And I just want to thank all the attendees and all the participants, all the panelists for a great 3 hours again, yet again, for the 140th time or something this year. And thank you all. It is always my pleasure to hang out with all of you. And thanks again to Brian for joining us. And Mickey, go ahead and hit it. Tomorrow and Saturday is both for educators. So it'll be just dedicated that 8 to 9. We're going to talk about it tomorrow. 9 to 11-ish. If there's more questions, we'll just keep going on Saturday. So if you've got educator friends, whether it's e-learning or college or K through 12, they're trying to figure this all out, have them come and hang out with us. All right. Thanks, everybody.